How often do you go on the treadmill?
Every day. Every day we go early before breakfast, before meditation just starts right away. Every day. I was born in a small town in eastern Poland, which once upon a time called Galicia. My father was a soldier in the First World War, and he lived in Germany.
Fight the Hulks. See that?
Yeah.
When Hitler declared war on Soviet Russia, my father came home with four horses and a big wagon.
Okay, ready.
And he told my mother, "I can hear the cannons. Pack up, we are leaving right now." They saved our lives. My father, yeah. When we got to the city Algar in Kazakhstan, there was a big chemical factory, and I applied as a kid to work in the factory. I was always interested in mechanical stuff. They wanted to convert opium for medical purposes. It has seeds. So I used to like to eat the seeds. Usually knocked me out to go to sleep. So I was caught once or twice sleeping. The manager of the whole department, the Russian guy, and he threatened me, "If I catch you once more sleeping, I'll send you into the military." I caught my father. I said, "Dad, this manager soon will send me to the Russian military, and I don't want to go to the Russian military. But there's a Polish brigade forming on the Eastern Front, and I know a little bit about it. I have a lot of friends that knew what's going on." He said, "What do you want to do?" I said, "I want to recruit myself to the Polish army." So they accepted me to the what they call 1st Polish Pontoon Brigade. Reading and writing and driving a truck to go bring in all kind of stuff to the food and whatever necessary. I was the chief supplier.
The Germans left Lublin a city of ghosts and ruins. They had destroyed its churches, its university, its monuments, and they had tried to destroy the Polish language itself.
We were stationed close to Lublin. Sure enough, we wound up in Majdanek.
Auschwitz and Majdanek were both concentration camps as well as extermination camps. Majdanek was just 1.5 miles from Lublin.
I was in Polish uniform. Most of the soldiers were in Russian uniform. A lot of the Russian doctors and nurses were helping the prisoners of war, mostly Russians and Jewish. And this was the first that they found out what Hitler was doing in these concentration camps. The ovens were still hot. I didn't know how many Jews there, so I started walking around. I walked over and I said, "Cancer in Yiddish, you know what it means? Do you speak Yiddish?" He shook up and he started yelling, "I can't write in Yiddish, I can't write in Yiddish." He ran around like this yelling that I know how to speak Yiddish. I was proud to be Jewish. I'm still proud to be Jewish. Not afraid of it. I like the margarita, but no olives. After the war, my father opened a store where he sold tea and cookies. The people used to come for snacking. One day, there's a huge crowd of Polacks standing and yelling at my father. Jit, and I ran back with my truck to my brigade. I had a big machine gun, and I started shooting in the air nonstop, and they disappeared. Packed up my father, I said, Dad, let's get home. We came home and we told our mother what happened. And she said, we are leaving Poland tonight. No questions! I'll never forget it. She went like this, no questions!
What time did you get into the Lens?
Oh, it was about something like 10:30.
My father decided to move where there was the American occupation, next to Linz, Austria, big city. And that's where we settled. The United Nations supplied food and all kind of other stuff for refugees. With several other young men, we became members of Menachem Begin's underground organization, the Etzel, Irgun Tzvai Lumi. We had 27 kids join the group, and we are the ones that eventually go to the Alta Lena. That's me right here. They were able to take only about 1,200 because the Alta Lena had a lot of guns and ammunition. And basically, Menachem Begin had an agreement with Ben Gurion that when the ship comes, 20% of the ammunition would go to the underground. But Ben Gurion didn't keep his promise. Thirteen people got killed on the ship because of his order. When I mention his name, I use a cuss word. That's how I joined in the Israeli army. After the state was established, they told us, you gotta come. My military number is 9-4-7-2-1. Never forget it. This shows that I was volunteered in the Israeli army. After I finished in Israel with the military, I came back to the camp in Austria. My parents were there, my brother, and we decided to leave Austria. In other words, we were stateless. See, that's me in here. The American embassy called my parents. We have permission to let you go to the United States. I came with them, they looked at the papers, you can't go. Why can't I go? You're too old, you have to apply by yourself. My mother, my father, and my brother left for the United States and they wound up in Minneapolis. And I was able to go to Canada. I went with a ship called USS Nellie. I wound up in Halifax. I spoke to the people and said, you have to have money to buy a ticket to go to Montreal. If you don't have money to buy a ticket, we're sending you back to Austria. Rolled up my sleeve, took off my shirt, showing my muscles. Give me a job. Within a few hours, a truck drove up with three people and said, come on, we have a ship to unload. $1 an hour. I made enough money to buy a ticket to Montreal.
Well, I was born 1933. I was born Ann Ruth Robinson. I had lived in a town of 1,400 population, about 30 miles outside of Houston. I never got to know my mother. She had passed away when I was 1 year old. She and my father originally came from a little farming community fairly close to Bialystok.
The
men from Texas mean it when they say that whenever the United States goes to war, Texas can be counted on to fight right alongside her.
My father was a soldier in the American Army in World War I. He's my hero. I just was crazy about him. I remember my father, may he rest in peace, gave us every Sunday of his life. And that was the only day that the store was not open. And he would drive us to Galveston or to Houston to the zoo. I had really good times with him. And he would always either crack pecans for me or he'd be peeling turnips. When my mother died, there was a law in Texas that when a mother dies, the father is beholden to divide his assets among the three children. And so he invested that money, and consequently, I really had a good sum of money when I was 21 years old. And that's how we had a toehold in getting ahead a little bit.
From England, and Ned arrives with us to come here.
I love being here. The people are warm, friendly, and they want to be helpful. I talk other people into doing my work.
This woman helped me out. He has known this gal.
And it's been thankful for them. My second mother was a widow and had a little boy, and she was living with her in-laws in Duluth. So when she received an offer to go down to Texas and marry some guy that could support her, it sounded good to her, you know. I don't think they were anywhere near a match, but that's the way it was handled. My life changed when I moved to Minnesota. I was envious of people that had a family life. And I had never seen a stronger family life than my uncle and aunt had. And so I wanted to emulate them. My mother's brother, Shepsel Roberts, was the world's kindest man. And even though he had four children of his own, he took me by the hand one day and he said, I'm going to take you to the home of a rabbi and he's going to teach you the alphabet in Hebrew. And my uncle then enrolled me into the Talmud Torah. So I would go after school and study there. I never had ever heard the word kosher or Sabbath. I'd never had heard those words before. My second mother had just remarried for the third time. So I wasn't that happy at home. It's strange to get a new father again when you're 16. I had not been out with the great many of boys. I never even knew about setting people up, but a woman was telling Mark's mother about me. I had just turned 19, I think, and I received a phone call from what sounded like a young man. And he said, we would like to invite you over for coffee, and we only live about four blocks away from you. I walked over there, and they started telling me their story, and it was a heartbreaking story. because this was a family unit, but there were no other relatives because they had all perished in the Holocaust. And one of their sons was living in Montreal, Quebec, because he could not get a visa when they did to come to the United States. And they could not go to visit him. And so when they asked if I would let their son write to me, I said, okay, go let him go ahead and write to me.
I was a confirmed bachelor, so-called.
Where do you get that confirmed business?
I don't know, I'm just teasing.
I know, but you must like the word.
We exchanged pictures and we exchanged letters. So that is not a bad start.
After several months, he said to me, I cannot come to meet you, and I'm inviting you to come and visit me.
So she was going to University of Minnesota, and she wrote me a letter, said, I have summer free, I'm going to visit you. She came to Montreal. When I saw her the first time, I said to myself, this got to be it.
He'd been used to people looking gaunt during the Second World War. And there was one thing I definitely was not, was gaunt, because I've always been chubby. So I must have looked good to him.
I already had a big job. I worked in a factory that makes airplanes. I was making $1.75 an hour, night shift, saved a lot of money. So I said to Enrique, come on, let's meet.
And the man spent money like it was water, took me out for every meal, and for Pete's sake, I don't know why, but he would take me by taxi instead of taking a bus to go someplace. And he was very good to me. And he was a great dancer. And when it came to the tango, man, I'm telling you, this guy likes a good time.
You still have some moves, Mark, no?
Yeah, sure.
So he said to me, I don't want you to leave. I want you to stay here and marry me. I said, all right, I'll marry you.
After a few weeks, we finally said, let's tie the knot, got married.
We went on a lavish honeymoon for a day and a half. And we went to the Laurentian Mountains and we stayed in a place where you had to walk down the hall to use the bathroom. Then my husband said he was broke. He didn't have money to pay the bill for the hotel because he'd spent all his money on entertaining me. And that is where you really meet Mark Hasten.
One day, Ruth's brother came, Jerome, said, why don't you come to Texas, meet the rest of the family? And I liked it very much. I said to her, you know what, how about if we move to Dallas?
I took $1,600 or $1,400 of my money, and I bought a two-bedroom frame house for us in a section of Dallas that looked as though it was the direction in which people were moving. One day I read in the newspaper, Southern Methodist University was offering a course in engineering. I went with them to SMU And I remember that they threw us out. They said, "That's ridiculous. You can't, how can you possibly go to university when you don't even read and write English?"
She said to him, "You don't know my husband. He's a stubborn guy. He doesn't just get rid of him." As I was walking out, one of the professors was walking in, and he stopped. He said, he tried to shake my hand. He took out the hand, didn't have an arm. I was shocked. I said, "What happened?" I spoke a little English already. He was a soldier in the Second World War, lost his arm. So I said, "I was a soldier in the Second World War too," and I started talking to him. He said, "You come back. We'll get you in." Wood was my English professor. A lot of this stuff was known to her. She already went to University of Texas and to University of Minnesota. So I used to come home and consult with her a lot of the things, and it helped dramatically. And I showed up in class, and professor of chemistry said to me, "What are you doing here?" I said, "What are you talking about? Do you know today's Yom Kippur?" I said, "I'm sorry." I took off, went home, and said to him, "Do you know, Hanrazel, today's Yom Kippur?"
And I said, "Our children won't even know that they're Jewish until we start living differently than the way we live now." And he agreed with me.
And we changed. Started having kosher, started observing. When I graduated, we decided to move from Texas to Minneapolis, where my parents are.
Hub and crossroads of the state, Minneapolis, the sounding board for the progressive Upper Mississippi Valley.
And I started with General Mills and researched at the engineering department. And that was a lot of fun. So this is potato flour mixed with other ingredients. I always like to be inventive. One day we were sitting around a table and I had an ice cream cone and I didn't finish the bottom. And I tossed it on the table. I turned around to a couple of my friends and said, "If you make the product, I'll make the machines for it." So that's my first invention, the bugles. Then it started, bugles, whistles, daisies, Pringles.
A picnic without potato chips?
What do you think these are?
Potato chips in this?
Pringles, newfangled potato chips.
Every single Pringles potato chip is a perfect potato chip.
They're not broken, fresh and crunchy too.
Cheerios is my invention.
Cheerios. Great way to start the day with really great eating. That's Cheerios, one of the few foods made from oats. The tasty cereal grain everyone should have at breakfast.
You know, the flexible straw is my invention. I made 18 patents for General Mills. I had to sign a document that whatever I do belongs to them. General Mills sold some of that stuff for billions of dollars.
I had a diamond ring that had been left from my first mother. And when the bank appraised it, it was worth $10,000. So Mark used that as collateral to go shopping for a piece of property. And Mark found two apartment buildings next to one another in a suburb called Fridley, Minnesota. When his brother wanted us to go into business, we sold the buildings and had money to go into business with him.
So Hart shows up at my door one day. He said, "You know, we are both working for Bemis Beck Company. I work for General Mills. Why can't we do some for ourselves?" So what did he suggest? He said, "I opened this nursing home of 49 beds, come join me." And I moved from Minneapolis to Indianapolis. to start planning, building nursing homes. The doctors liked it very much. And at the end, we wound up building 10 nursing homes. I was always negotiating with a bank to get a loan to build and so on. One day I was sitting with a banker and he was kind of crutchy. So Hart calls me up. He said, "Why are you such a long time there?" I said, "This guy is very crutchy. So what do you think, we should go into the banking business?" I said, "Yes." We went into the banking business. And at one given time, I was the commissioner of the banking system in the state of Indiana. Well, I like for kids to get education all the way through college. It's a very important aspect that makes me very happy.
Anyone who wanted to go to night school while they were employees of Mark and Hart paid their tuition.
We had a method that said, if you want to go to school, we will pay you tuition and you don't have to work for us.
Our daughter Monica heard a man talk about a new college that had opened. She came home and she said, "You know, Mother, I'd like to go to that college."
Touro got started in New York as a liberal arts college with only 30 entering students in its first class in 1971. Touro College was established by Dr. Bernard Lander to help those young Jews rediscover the Jewish names they or their parents had long forgotten, to build Jewish life in the United States, Israel, and Europe.
One day, maybe a year after she'd started there, there was somebody at our doorstep, Dr. Bernard Lander and a friend of his, and he said, "I just couldn't imagine what kind of a family from Indianapolis into Indiana would be sending their daughter to my college in New York. And my husband is capable of working like a maniac for things that he believes in."
I got involved in education. And to me, education is a very important item. I think that the United States should educate everybody. We can afford it. We can afford to be the number one country that teaches kids better than anywhere else in the world. That was my aim. We opened a Hebrew day school in Indianapolis, my brother and I. It's been about 50 years old. The kids graduate, they go on to colleges. The same thing here with Touro. I'm the chair of the Board of Trustees. And we have a lot of medical schools, also law school and other things to teach students from all over the world. I like to go to graduations, shake hands with the students. A lot of fun for me.
They asked me to once speak to the girls at Touro. And I told them, I said, "If you're gonna go for a job interview, you must tell the person who's interviewing you that you are capable of doing anything in the world, that if they will be so happy that they've employed you." I think that that's a winner.
We would ask the kids, "Don't get an education, do you want to be a truck driver?"
Yeah.
That's what you used to say.
And that's what our boys wanted to be. They wanted to be truck drivers. We're lucky that we have very good children and they like one another and they're very fair to one another.
The only thing I wanted for my children, respect. Respect your father and mother. And they learned that. Very respectful of my wife.
Where would I be today if I didn't have the most wonderful children that ever came to this earth? They would swim both oceans to help my husband and myself. You can't buy that.
Edward, several years ago, asked my husband, Mark, what it was like to be married for such a long time. And my husband said, well, the first 25 years were hard, and then it got harder.
We married September the 12th, 1952. It's 66 years.
I tell her every time, I love you. She tells me I love you too, so this is what it is.
I wasn't going to marry anybody that wasn't crazy about me. Because I needed love. I really needed love. He's been a tough guy to live with for many reasons. But I'm a tough lady.
She loves people. She loves the family very much so. And she loves our kids very much so. And if she doesn't like I say something, she tells me. She's always right. She's always right. I believe very much in independence. Self-educated and independence is very important. It's important to be friendly. Listen to what the person has to say. And if it's somewhere that you can help, go out and do it.
Treat other people the way you want to be treated. I can't think of anything better than that. I doubt if Churchill would ever have thought that my husband sounded like him with my husband's Polish accent. But he said in World War II, you never, never, never give up. And that's my husband's credo for all of life. You never, never give up. And he hasn't.
Together for fun or just on a day-to-day?
Well, if he really wants me to consent to something, he'll play Rummy Cue with me. Only one game though, not more than that. But that's about it.